Welcome to our conversation about expanding the table. We've decided over the course of this entire series that we're going to take a little bit of time each week to kind of unpack and dig deeper into some of our questions that we have from the sermon series and engage on what would it look like to live out expanding our own tables for the presence of Christ in new and powerful ways as we live into our Thanksgiving experience, right? We all have crazy Thanksgiving tables, and this gives us a chance to do that. So my name is Rustin. I'm the lead pastor here at St. Matthew, and I'm glad that you're joining us.
And I'm Mike, the associate pastor here in charge of digital and connection. And so it's been fun to kind of get into this last series to hear this last week's message. If you haven't listened to it, feel free to click on the link below. It's in the comments section, and you can kind of listen to what Reverend Tenamore had to share with us.
Yeah, and we also want to thank Takashi Tenamore for joining us. If you didn't know, he is a survivor of the bombing in Hiroshima, which took his entire family and his eyesight. Yeah. And so he came and talked to us about radical forgiveness in really powerful ways.
Yeah, I was overwhelmed by his story is a great way to start. Just hearing what his life journey has taken him on. And one of the takeaways that I really had from, you know, wrestling with what he was saying was, you know, how do we respond to those that really, are out to, I don't know if it's out to get us, really want to hurt us, you know, talking about war in Japan, you know, the American response, you know, and how we really bombed Hiroshima and Nagasaki on purpose to really kind of send this point home. You know, I've read the stories about how the Americans, you know, signed these bombs, you know, and wrote their names on them, and really what might be seen as disrespectful or dishonoring today, you know. And so how do we wrestle with this idea of justice and forgiveness, you know? And man, he has such an interesting story about wanting to come to America, not because he had the opportunity, but really because he wanted to hurt us, right? He wanted to hurt Americans. And you'll have to listen to his whole story to really kind of, you know, get that. But Romans 12, you know, 17 through 21 says a little bit about this. And it says, repay no one evil for evil, but give thought to what is honorable in the sight of all. If possible, so as it depends on you, live peaceably with all. Beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave it for the wrath of God. For it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay it, says the Lord. Now, I know sometimes we take that scripture out of context and we harbor things that we shouldn't be harboring and saying,
God's going to kick your bum, right?
And that's not what the scripture is saying. But the scripture is addressing this idea of when someone does something wrong to you, how do you respond?
Yeah, and I think, you know, part of what we saw in Reverend Takashi's presentation is this move towards nonviolence that you see in Jesus as well. Mm. And what do we do as followers of the way of Jesus when we want to respond violently and we see this call of nonviolent response, right? Like, how do we, like, you can't have worse happen to you than Reverend Tenamore, right? Like, he lost all of his family, including his siblings, grandfather, parents, and went blind. Yeah. And
in an honor-based culture, right?
Honor-based culture.
What he endured was life-altering to the point where he wanted to take his own life. He couldn't.
Yeah, and live. He was homeless, virtually, right? Homeless, full of shame. And so, how do you make that turn, right? Like, how do we walk in the way of Jesus in a way that empowers us into this nonviolent resistance, but also this nonviolent response to people's pain towards us?
I'm always blown away. Again, you know, this Jesus passage, Matthew 5, where, you know, Jesus says, you've heard eye for an eye, tooth for a tooth. But, you know, Jesus says, do not resist the one who is evil, but if anyone slaps you on the right cheek, turn to him the other also. If anyone would sue you, take your tunic, let them have your cloak as well. If anyone forced you to go 1 mile, go with them 2 miles. Give to the one who begs from you. Do not refuse the one who would borrow from you. And the scripture goes on. But I've always been intrigued there because I've heard some explanation, maybe you know, about the whole idea of like the tunic and the cloak and then going the extra mile.
Yeah.
You know, and how...
That it is actually a resistance. It's not a... Like we read this in our lens as Jesus just saying, take it.
Yeah.
Right? Become a doormat.
Exactly. Yeah.
But that wouldn't be how the Hebrew person would have understood that, right? They would have understood that a Roman person can require you to carry their bag for a mile. But anything beyond that would be considered cruel treatment from a Roman soldier.
Yeah.
So for you then to say, well, I'll carry it a second mile. Now, and granted, this wasn't the Roman soldier was carrying it. The mule was carrying it.
Correct.
Now you're carrying what the mule was carrying.
Yes.
For you to carry it a second mile is basically a righteous stand against the mistreatment of your people, right? That like, I'm going to show people how inappropriate this is.
Yeah.
You know, like, I don't have anything but a cloak, so now I'm standing naked.
Yeah.
And showing the neighborhood that you're asking for more than your what's right.
Yeah. And so, again, it's one of those things that, you know, is taken out of context. And so as we read it, again, as first century reader, or as we read it as now versus first century readers, right, we don't understand what they're trying to get at, and we miss the point. And, again, there's this idea, I think, that's present in Scripture. I do believe in nonviolence. I do believe in taking things that way. But, you know, Dietrich Bonhoeffer is one of the greatest examples. Like, what do you do when there is evil, when you're presented with evil? How do you confront that?
Yeah.
You
know? And if you don't know, Dietrich planned to kill Hitler, right? He had a whole scheme of how he was going to kill Hitler and got thrown in prison for it.
Yeah, and eventually lost his life because of that. There's a great, what's that movie? Valkyrie.
Yeah.
Tom Hanks.
Yeah.
Or no, Tom Cruise. It's
Tom Cruise.
Tom Cruise. Yeah, but anyways, whole another subject. And so again, it's really interesting as we, you know, it is a hard topic to wrestle with because there is wrong. That's the one thing we do know. There is wrong. There is.
Yeah, there's evil in the world.
Yeah.
Right? And it may not be personified, but like dropping a nuclear bomb was evil.
Yeah.
That's something, and that's something we have to own, right? Like, and again, that I'm not making political statements about war. I'm saying that wiping out a population with a bomb is not God-honoring, and I'm not going to argue that it is.
The one thing I've been blown away by in the last few weeks is just the study I've been doing on the sacredness of human life and how oftentimes we use that term when it's correct for us or appropriate for us, and not when it's we don't necessarily fall through in the whole scope of it, and to realize how, you know, once you or I are gone, there's not another you or I happening anywhere else, you know, and maybe that's good or bad, but, but you know, there is that thing where every life is a gift from God. If we believe we're created in the image of God, created in, you know, the image of this big creator, and we bear his fingerprints, then all of us are really important.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I mean, I think one of the things that we saw in Takashi's story is truthfully the power of humanity, right? Like we can do really horrible things like drop nuclear bombs and that wipe out entire cities.
Yeah.
But we can also do really powerfully beautiful things. And so, you know, he talks about this one nurse who taught him about the love of Jesus and stood up for him in court, like not just in the hospital with the doctors, but even all the way into a court situation for him to have his freedom, and then walked with him once he was out of the hospital situation, right? Like the true Good Samaritan picture here in real life, Mary, how do you engage that, right? So there's this like powerful capacity that we have as being part of the Imago Dei or the image of God to do God's work. Mm-hmm. Like to be the hands and feet of the presence of Jesus to our neighbor, to those that come into our purview, right?
Yeah.
I just think it was such a powerful contrast of like, we can destroy life or we can redeem and resurrect life.
I mean, if there isn't a more powerful image of Jesus that was presented, I mean, Mary, right? Standing in the gap, the advocate, if you would, right? For him when he had no voice of his own. What a story. Right.
Yeah.
What a story. How we, you know, and how can we carry that? I think that's, I think my big takeaway from Sunday was just that. How do we become now that advocate, you know, the work of the Spirit, you know, how can we see that happen in our own life and speak up for those that have no voice. And, you know, in our situation, our country, there's lots of people that have no voice or on the margins, if you would. And so learning how to see with God's eyes in a new way and to come to the aid of those, you know, that are less than, that are other, right? Yeah. And how can we remove that language, you know, from our vocabulary?
And how do we make room at the table? Right? Yeah. Like, I mean, that's what Mary did for him in the truest sense of the fashion. Like, Mary invited him into her home, invited her, like, to the point of like, no, like, I'm creating a new seat in my family relationship for you. Like, that's what we're doing this for, right? This is the conversation we're having, is how do we expand both our proverbial thought tables, to make room for other people, but how also do we extend our real tables to make room for people who aren't usually sitting at them?
Yeah. I've been reading Gregory Boyle this last week, and he is a great example of, you know, how do you change that language? How do you make your table a place where everyone literally is welcome? And one of the things he gets at is just starting that change of, you know, there's no such thing as other. We're all created in God's image. We're all his kingdom, as you would say. Yeah. And we're all family. So,
yeah, I love that. And I think we saw another great example of that this week.
Yeah. Well, that's all the time we have for today. We hope that you're enjoying these times. And again, all the links to the Sunday sermons and previous weeks in our talks are in the comments below. We'd love for you to join us each Sunday. We're live, we're digital, we're all the different ways. And also find us on Facebook and Instagram.
Perfect. Have a good day. God bless.
All right. See you next week.